fashion label BIBA is the very epitome of London in the swinging 60s, but actually it has quite a Brighton connection too. Barbara Hulanicki, the designer behind the brand, grew up in Brighton and went to boarding school in Worthing. So this autumn, Brighton and Hove Museum and Art Gallery has a major retrospective called BIBA and Beyond, which is about the designer and her work. But Barbara, BIBA is associated, I think, with London in the swinging 60s. But of course, you have a big long history in Brighton. You moved to Brighton when you were, I think, 12.
Yes.
Tell me about some of your memories of Brighton.
Yes. Well, Brighton was completely different. It was very, it was a real seaside, sleepy town in the winter. I went to boarding school in Worthing, and then I went to art school here, which was great fun, but you know, fashion students were really looked down on. You were sort of like one of those, they called us. It's terrible. When you think of it now, a whole building is for fashion now. Had to draw all these really fat nude models, which wasn't glamorous enough for me.
And Brighton was quite different in those days. Like your first shop here, I believe there's quite an interesting story. It was kind of run by gangsters, wasn't it?
Well, the manageress was a gangster's mall, which straight out of Graham Greene's book, you know. It was very quirky here. It was really wonderful.
And getting back to the clothes, what led you to start BIBA? You were originally a fashion illustrator at the time, and then you moved into designing, and then this became a whole chain. How did this start?
Absolute despair for young clothes. Can you imagine a world with no young clothes, only sort of couture stuff, and really boring attitude? And everybody was dying for something sort of that belonged to their generation, and that was rebellious. I mean, it's very difficult to think that this is rebellious, but it was.
The place was very important, wasn't it? I mean, your shops have a very visual design. I mean, the big BIBA boutique, it was almost like a theme park, wasn't it?
Yes. Theatrical. Yeah, I mean, that's what we enjoyed, and we were there 24 hours a day.
This exhibition sums up basically your life and your life's work. How does it feel looking at this today? You've just seen it for the first time.
I feel they should have done it when I was dead. Really. It's very, very nice, very exciting to look through somebody else's eyes, because you've all got your own, you know, sort of memories.
Martin, you curated this exhibition. Where did the idea come from and how long have you been planning it for?
Well, there's been an idea to do a BIBA exhibition for about 10 years. And then I happened to meet Barbara in 2009 and we sat down, we spoke about a BIBA exhibition, and then we decided to actually expand it into a Barbara Hulanicki exhibition. So it covers everything from her early childhood through to 2012.
And has she worked very closely with you throughout to pick what's going into the exhibition?
Absolutely. There's lots of ungenuine BIBAs out there, but Barbara's seen everything here and they're all genuine BIBAs.
And it's very personal about her and aspects of her life as well as the fashion. Why did you choose to do it that way?
Well, because it is a Barbara Hulanicki story, you know, so we decided to just have everything very much with Barbara's voice. So you have lots of quotes throughout the exhibition, so it's Barbara telling the story of her life through her own words. I think the reason people are so fond of BIBA is because it was the first time in sort of fashion history that everybody was able to sort of access great design. Whereas, you know, in the 50s you had Mary Quant, who sort of made costume or fashion very young, but it was still very expensive. And then BIBA came along, or Barbara, and changed all that. You know, it was, you can say it was a Topshop of its day, but actually it was a much bigger, stronger brand. It had a bigger identity. So, you know, people fell in love with BIBA. They're still in love with BIBA.